standard, the power of his blood.
The battle belongs to the Lord, and we sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord. We sing glory, honor, power and strength to the Lord.
Good morning. Welcome to Harbor Christian Fellowship. Whoa, hit me with the lights. There you go. So we know that there's storm brewing out there, and I think many people have felt it might not be safe to be out in the storm, so they stayed home today. But we're still here to praise God, to worship, and to fellowship, so don't give up on that part of it. We're going to start with praise to the Lord the Almighty. Let's stand as well. Good. Praise to the Lord the Almighty, King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is thy health and salvation. All ye who now to His temple draw near, praise Him in great adoration. Praise to the Lord, who of all things so wondrously reigneth, shelters thee under His wings, so gently sustaineth. If thou shalt see how thy desires there have been granted in what He praise to the Lord, who doth work and defend thee. Surely His goodness and mercy here daily attend thee. Ponder anew what the Almighty can do, if with His love He friend thee. Praise to the Lord and adore Him. All that hath life and breath, come now with praises before Him. Let the Amen sound with His people again. Gladly for life we adore Him. I think we'll know the next one a little bit better than that one and all those words passing by. And my eyes were watering, and so I couldn't see the words very well. Our God, the one that we lift up in praise, is an awesome God. That's easy. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome. Let's do it again. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Amen. We lifted that one up. John, John's going to come and make announcements.
Morning, church. Welcome you this morning on this crazy stormy day. We just ask that you be with us as we get through this. When I was asked to do the announcements, it reminded me about on my way to work. Everybody can sit down. Sorry. During COVID, there's a wall in Huntington Beach that somebody in big, huge block letters spelled out faith, not fear. And I tell you, I know it sounds like a bumper sticker thing, but there, throughout the Bible, faith and fear are themes that are just woven through the Old and New Testament. And I can't tell you how many times I've driven by that sign, and it's given me encouragement. I've prayed for the people that did it. I don't know if they just one night went out and did that or they got permission, but it's been there. Nobody's graffitied over it or the city. I don't think it made them take it down, but it's an encouragement to me. And even this morning, I was like, I don't know if I can get to church, but storming weather. And I just decided last night, faith, not fear. And that really has kind of sustained me for a few things over the last few years. But anyway, so I thought I'd bring that to you. Few announcements. Charles Jones fund that we're gathering up for August. We are close to a milestone, so I would like for you to prayerfully consider giving to that ministry. I know Ernestine came up a few weeks ago and just gave that heartfelt talk about how it affects her family and the church family, and I know that that's a very important ministry to our church and the children's school in Cameroon. Next up, Awana's. Awana's is starting up again, and there's going to be a meeting on September 6th, and that is going to be at 6 o'clock. It's a registration and meet and greet night. So that's encouraging. We haven't run Awana's for so many years, and I know that they are in still need of some help, but just ask that you prayerfully support that, whether it's through prayer or the fact that you can come and help in a small way. And then I want to pray for Pastor Danny and his family as he recovers and gets some diagnosis on how he's doing. And we know that and I know he knows that we're behind him and that we are prayerfully hoping for his quick recovery. And that's a couple more things. The Maui families, that is just heartbreaking to see that. Effects of a hurricane, very similar, that people go through all the time in different parts of the world, and we just want to lift up them. And then lastly, Audrey's son Tim's in the ICU, and I don't know the details, but she does, and God knows. So just lift them up for strength and healing for Tim. Haley's, Greg's granddaughter Haley is also in the, she got into a car accident, in the hospital with some broken bones, some more severe than others. So there are many, many reasons to pray and support your loving church family today. So lastly, save the date for Kids Alive. There's a registration on August 25th, 7 to 9, and that's at you start this Friday. Oh, okay. Because it does say registration. Okay, but you start. So that, praise the Lord. Okay. And that's going to be from 7 to 9 on Friday night coming up. So with that, I'll go ahead and pray. Father God, we just thank you for those that are here that have endured the storm. And we just know that they're so faithful. We thank you for those that are in service for you here at the local church. We pray for Victor C. and his many ministries and his strength and health. And we just thank you for his leadership throughout the country. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
God is good?
All the time.
Good morning. Children, if you'd like to come up here to God's schoolhouse up here, come on up. And this morning, we have a special presenter. Pastor Victor is going to bring you God's word.
All right.
Pastor Victor, welcome.
I'll just leave this up here for the big kids and take care of the little kids. Good morning, everybody. How's everybody doing? And how are the most important people in the church? How are you guys doing? My name is Victor. I have more letters in my last name than the whole alphabet. How many of you guys know the alphabet? Raise your hand. Pretty good. All right. So my name is Victor. What is your name and how old are you? Reagan, and you're six. Wow, getting old, huh? Fantastic. How old are you?
Oh, what's your name?
Three. Wow, you're three. Good job. How many is three? Can you show me on your hands? Not right now. Okay, really good. What's your name?
Kennedy,
I'm 10. Kennedy and 10, double digits. Way to go. Fantastic. Oh, look at you. You're ready. I like your sweater.
McKinley.
McKinley and you're five. Fantastic. Welcome, McKinley. All right. Okay. My brother up here. All right. What is your name?
My name is Declan and I'm 8 years old.
Declan and you're 8 years old. Declan, thank you for being up here or else I would be really nervous if you weren't up here with me. Okay. I appreciate you. And what is your name?
Sade and I'm
13. Sade and you're 13. I like that. I like that. Let's clap it up for our children. You guys are the most important part of the church. Church, you don't have a future, all right? And so are you the future as we're helping you in the next generation become the now generation, right? So guys, this morning I'm talking about storms, right? People are kind of like wet out there. People, you might be hearing them talk about a storm is coming. You might hear it on the news. And it kind of made me go, guys, because what is a storm? Can any of you raise your hand and tell me what a storm is? Oh my gosh, what did you say?
A
thunder. Did you guys hear that? Let's clap it up for that. Come on, we can't clap for children. We have a rock. That's right. Yeah, a storm is a thunder. Can you make the noise of thunder?
No.
No. But is it a loud sound?
Yes.
Yes. It's like, oh, right? First you have a flash, right? And then you can wait and see the time. And if it's...
Ohio.
Whoa, there is one in Ohio too. That's right. Fantastic. Yeah, so storm has thunder. What else does storms have?
Lightning.
That's right. Lightning. Don't worry, we're going to get you, okay? Lightning, that's right. In fact, if you see the flash and all of a sudden there's a noise, you know that the lightning is close, right? Did you know that? Yeah, tell me about that.
Lightning comes from
clouds. That's right. Right? Crowds running into each other. That's right. What else do storms have? What else do storms have? Hail! Wow, you didn't say hell, did you? How Southern Baptist of you. That's great. Yeah, you said hail. And what is hail?
I don't know.
I know, but it's something. Do you know hail?
It's ice.
It's ice that falls from where?
From the snow when there's an iceberg.
That's right, yeah. It's snow just like an iceberg. It falls from the sky when it's super cold up there. There's hail. What else is there? It's like covering the ground out there. I just swooshed through it in my minivan. What else is there? Yes?
Rain.
There is tons of rain, and so we have to drive a little bit slower. Here in California, it rains and we all freak out. We go buy toilet paper and we start driving faster. It's really interesting. Yeah. So there's these storms, and they say there's a big storm coming this way. In fact, they call it a hurricane. And they name these things after the people's names. Does anybody know the name of this hurricane that's coming this way? It's named after a former president's wife, who some would say is also as powerful as a storm. That's right. Hillary! Can you say Hillary?
Yeah.
That's right. All right. Can storms be scary?
Yes. Yeah.
Yes. Can storms be powerful?
Yes. Yeah.
Can storms mess things up?
Yeah.
Okay, in fact, when I go later on to my backyard, I'm sure a lot of my little kids' toys are going to be all over the place. This is what I'll ask you this morning. Are storms more powerful than God?
No.
What was that?
No.
You clapping up for that? How about you guys? I mean, I might as well get to the end of the sermon the other day. Are storms more powerful than God?
No.
All right, so you guys agree with you guys. Okay, good, because this is the age spectrum here. That's good, all right? That's good. Our storms are not more powerful than our God. And what is our God's name? His name is?
Jesus.
Oh, man. Say Jesus.
Jesus.
That's right. Jesus, right? You smile, Jesus, right? There is no storm that comes into your life, whether at your school, at your house, or throughout your life, that is more powerful than your God, okay? And throughout your life, I want you to remember that. If you get real scared during a storm, I want you to pray to Jesus, because Jesus can control the storms, okay? All right, can one of you guys pray for all of the people that are going to be going through this storm right now, that we stay safe, and you're going to pray? Okay, all right, everybody, says you won't pray, so bow your heads, close your eyes. All right, let's pray, and don't worry, I'll help you. Yes, thank you for praying for your grandpa and grandma. Does anybody, that was wonderful, we should pray for our grandpa and grandma. Can we pray for the people that are going through the storm? Who would like to do that?
Starts out, you give life, you give love, light to the darkness, that's who our God is.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken.
Because of that, we sing,
Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise.
Sing a solo or something. You know, without breath in our lungs, it just isn't going to happen. What I often say is that God gives us all the same vocal mechanism. We have vocal cords, we have breath that comes out of our lungs, we have ears to hear, and a mouth to pronounce the words. All of those things are in place. We won't be able to do that. So I'm going to share a song with you now. And you'll find that you know it and you're going to want to sing along, and I invite you to do that. But this just goes further with, it is a prayer. It is telling Jesus why I love him. And you can think it if you don't sing it, but you can sing it.
My gracious Redeemer, Good morning, everybody, again. Greg, thank you so much for that. You know, I really do. I don't want to just learn to sing. I want to learn to sing like you, brother. You have a beautiful voice. Thank you for starting us with that special song. That's one of my favorite songs. It's a song that gives me great peace, and peace is kind of what we need on a day like this. And I'm proud of you. I'm proud of you guys for braving the storm. You literally braved the storm this morning to come out to see not your normal preacher, but it's DOM Sunday, not Dumb Sunday, but Director of Mission Sunday, where your friend, Pastor Victor, who, as we get to know each other better, hopefully you'll come to know and love a little bit more. We certainly love you, is honored to be here. We want you to know that we love Pastor Danny. We continue to pray for him. We're praying that he gets better and gets well, and he's back here soon to help lead this church. But in the meanwhile, you guys have been going strong. It was a joy to be here and to visit during one of the days of your VBS. And actually, I came at the right time when you guys were eating. And you guys even invited me to eat with you. It was a joy to see that partnership. Churches partnering together to serve the Lord. So praise God for the opportunity to be here. It's been a long week last week, but we are here on the first day of the week. For me, school started last week. Yesterday I was up at Gateway Seminary trying to support a conference up there. All right. And so your denomination, your work in there, our part of the kingdom is going strong. But I was looking forward to being here today at Arbor Christian Fellowship. Can you imagine? There were churches and pastors that were calling me and asking me, should we have church today? Do you think that we should just not have church because the storm that is coming? And I said to them, are any of your churches in OC shutting down because the storm that's coming up through San Diego? I said, I haven't heard from nobody. I would be surprised to hear from anybody Because we in the OC, we go strong for the Lord. We love the Lord. And we are gathered here this morning. You are gathered here this morning, not to be entertained by me, not to be here just to meet with each other, not just because of tradition, although those things are great. Because you are here to worship God. And you wanted to show him, the Lord, as you are here for me, I am here for you, serving in this church together. So praise God for that. Everybody say praise God. Well, as we begin this sermon this morning, let us bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the opportunity once again to be here with my Arbor family. What a joy is to see some of them who I know and some of them who I don't know that well, Father God. I pray, Father, as I preach your word this morning, that you bless us, that you open our hearts and our minds to what you have to say to us this morning, Father God, and help it to make a difference. Father God, help it to calm the hearts of those who came in here with great worry, great anxiety, great trouble because of many things that are going on in their lives, Father God. I pray that your Holy Spirit right now grants them a peace that transcends all understanding, Father God. Be with those who might be on the way here, Father, keep them safe. And Father, who those who couldn't be here today because they weren't well, Father God, I pray that you heal them and help them to get better so they might return to us soon. Father, again, I pray that you give me the strength and the courage to preach the words that you placed on my heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, you know, I had a different sermon for you up until about Wednesday. And that's why when I got the text to say, hey, what are you preaching on? You know, it started to kind of, God started to put something else on my heart on Wednesday. And so I wasn't able to text back because God completely changed what I was going to preach to you guys on this Sunday. It was supposed to be a message from Romans 12 on holiness. I was sure it was going to be good. This was the one for Arbor Christian Fellowship. But then something started to happen, something started to change as I heard a hurricane might be forming, Hurricane Hillary coming up through Mexico and coming up here. And God started to put a different message on my heart. And so that's what I'm going to preach here this morning because I'm not up here doing what I want to do. I'm up here doing what he tells me to do and speaking the words he tells me to speak. Amen? But as I've been here more than once now, you know, and as I want to get to know you, I'm going to constantly come here and also tell you some things about me. That's just the way that I preach. And I hope that those stories resonate with you. And you go, hey, you know, that guy is just a normal guy like me. Oh, hey, he's been through some of the stuff that I've been through. And really, it allows us to have a conversation over lunch, conversation over coffee. Or, hey, if you need your director of mission in any sort of capacity, you know, I'd be happy to be there for you. You know, when I think of the storm that's coming up, the hurricane, it makes me think of the first hurricane that I've ever been through. Now, I'm somebody who likes to go to Florida, okay? We started visiting Florida every year. It's on the other side of the country. And so we had heard there were things called hurricanes, but we never experienced them. Oh, go to the last slide. The one before this one. Yeah, never experienced them, all right? But we heard that they existed, and every time we went there, we're like, hurricanes? Sure, it rains every day. But you know, it's good that it rains, especially during the summer. Because if it rains during the summer, that means that you're going to have cooler nights, right? And during cooler nights, if you're doing anything at night, the East Coast people get tired, but the West Coast people, we're just getting started, right? And so we're hoping for the rain. But my first experience with a hurricane in Florida was this. I was driving my rental car, little minivan with my family in the back of it, and I'm driving along, and the rain's coming down, much like maybe the rain came down today, all right, as you were driving here. You know, we know rain, it comes straight down, it hits on the thing, and the more that it hits on your windshield, the faster you gotta turn on your windshield wipers, right? And so maybe today you learned, some of you, that your windshield wipers are not good anymore and you need to go to AutoZone and change them, right? So I did that. I'm hitting the things and they're going really fast. And I'm like, wow, this rain's coming down really hard. So fast that my windshield wipers cannot wipe it away. But then something interesting happened, church. The rain, you know, the rain that usually comes up to down, straight down like this, all of a sudden the rain started going sideways. And I was like, something's happening here. Why is the rain going sideways? I turned on the radio, and of course the radio was saying, oh, the hurricane has hit, you know, Orlando, Florida. Please go to shelter. And I was like, oh man, if rain's going sideways, I probably should go back to the condo that we rented, right? And so I sped back over there because that was the first time I'd ever seen rain go sideways. And you know, at that moment when it went sideways, when things go sideways, what do? Well, I was praying the whole way. God, I got a couple kids back in the car. Please get me to that condo safely. And of course, did he get me there safely? Well, yeah, I'm standing right here. You guys still awake, church? I'm right here. All right, that's right. Okay. The second experience that I had with a big storm, you can give me the next slide, is a time where I decided to take my parents to Orlando. My mom and dad are still alive. My dad is going to turn 80 next year. My mom, I'm not going to tell you, okay? And she's younger than my dad. And I decided, you know what? Florida's so great, I want to take my parents through to Orlando. But again, I don't make as much money as everybody thinks that I did, so we decided to fly Frontier Airlines. It was my first experience with Frontier Airlines. I didn't know you had to pay for your carry-ons, and if your kid was carrying a bottle, you had to pay for that too. That was $5 or whatever, right? And so the thing about Frontier Airlines is they fly through a great state called Colorado. So we ended up stopping in Colorado because of weather, okay? And we didn't really know what kind of weather, we just knew it was bad weather. So we're sitting there in Colorado, and as we're waiting there to catch our flight to Florida, all of a sudden, I see the workers who are working the ice cream stand, the food stands. All of a sudden, you see them slowly start walking towards the stairwell. I was like, this is weird. I wanted a cup of coffee. How come they're closing their shops? And the next thing you know, after they're all in the stairwell, and it looks like a ghost town where you buy stuff, right? All of a sudden, there's alarm on the over the PA in the airport saying, oh, please stay away from the windows. There is a tornado heading towards the airport. And I said, tornado? We don't have tornadoes in Thailand. We hear about them a little bit sometimes down here in Southern California. There was like a small tornado in Buena Park, you know, picked up a car, threw it, or picked up a tree, put it into a car or whatever. But what is that? So, of course, when they say, get away from the windows, my dad, being a first-gen Asian dad, gets out his camera phone, and he starts walking towards the windows. And I'm like, Dad, they just said, don't, like, stay away from the windows. He's like, yeah, son. I'm doctor. I know what I'm doing. Me big, you small, right? And he starts walking towards the windows. Of course, he's walking towards the windows, so I'm his son who loves him. I'm kind of walking, but kind of behind him. So we're looking at the windows like, tornado? There's no tornado. It's beautiful out there. You know what I mean? What's everybody afraid of? And then about a minute later, the sky starts changing colors. Now, I've seen The Wizard of Oz. How many of you guys seen The Wizard of Oz? Raise your hand. All right, good, good. We're all on the same page here. That's good. All right. And you know, I've seen them when they add the color and everything like that, but I don't believe them. I did not believe it, okay, until that day. Because after a minute, the sky turned green. Green like I've never seen. The sky turned green. If you've never been towards a tornado, green like, surprisingly, the colors of Frontier Airlines. I thought they were doing some special effects or something, right? And, you know, slowly, as everything started to turn green, I said, Dad, we need to get away from this window, okay? Now, thankfully, we got away. The tornado did not hit the airport that we were in. Actually, they said it went over the airport, you know. And of course, as we saw this thing coming, what did we do? We prayed. I said, Dear God, please Please, I'm just trying to take my parents. I'm trying to be a good son here. Take my parents to Orlando and experience some of the good things. My dad wants to go to the Holy Land experience, which is now closed, but they have a wonderful How the Bible Made It Through the Times exhibit. Now you can go see it at the Bible Museum in Washington. Right, they had it there. I just want to say, Lord, please keep us safe. And thankfully, the tornado, it said it just kind of jumped over the airport, okay? And that was crazy. Two crazy things that I can remember where we were. I can remember what my faces, the faces of my kids looked like. And these are just crazy storms that I've experienced in our lives. But this morning, I want to look at a crazy storm, a storm that we've heard about in Scripture, all right? And a story that we've heard about in Scripture that we hear and hear and hear. We could probably recite, but we often forget when things happen in our lives. And what we're going to find out this morning is in Mark chapter 4. So will you bear with me and take out your Bible? Today I have my Bible on my phone. And this morning, even on this morning of this storm, right? We're going to hold our Bibles up. Everybody hold your Bible up real high for me. Let me see. Yes. All right, let's hold it up high together this morning. Hold it up high. I'm a doctor. I'm sorry. I got to get you to do this. You're important to me. All right. As we exercise this morning, go. One, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two. Switch hands. Oh, Lyles, you're going crazy back there. That's good, brother. All right, up high. Ready? Go! One, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two, one, two. Good. Exercising Christians make healthy Christians. Now open up your Bible, feed your mind and your soul. Open up your Bible app. Some of you that have it on your phones. I like my Bible. All right? Mark chapter 4. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. Okay, in the New Testament. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, and we're going to be in verses 35 to 41. To some of you, this is going to be an old friend. I hope it is, because again, this is one of my life verses, life stories that shapes my life that I remember. There's not a week where I don't need this story in my life, this account, this happened, right? And it goes like this. On that day, when evening had come, he told them, church, who is he? Are you guys still there? You're still with me? Come on, church. Who is he? Jesus. Are you still excited about Jesus? Oh, yeah, I hope you are. Okay, I'm excited about Jesus. If you can't tell, I'm sorry. I'm not faking it to make it. No, I love Jesus. I love talking about Jesus. And I'm excited about Jesus because I want the world to be excited about Jesus, right? All right, and on that day when evening had come, he told them, let's cross over to the other side of the sea. So they left the crowd and took him along since he was already in the boat. And the other boats were with him. Okay, so these guys, Jesus and his disciples, were at the sea. Does anybody, Bible scholars here, know what sea? What sea was it? Was it the Red Sea? No, that was the one that Moses parted. Was it the Reed Sea? No, that's the one in seminary they teach you that it wasn't the Red Sea, it was the Reed Sea, okay? Was it this? What sea was this? Anybody know? Starts with the G, ends with an E? Galilee! Everybody say Galilee! Oh man, we doing this together, family. Okay, that's right, the Sea of Galilee, okay? And on the Sea of Galilee, as they were sent forth, I'm sure it looked something like this. Put it up there. There it is. This is an image of the Sea of Galilee today. You can still go see the Sea of Galilee. You know why? Because that's, again, the stuff in the Bible that's happening are real places, real events for a real life which we live, which God has put us here to live. Okay? And so there's the Sea of Galilee. Calm, wonderful, beautiful. Doesn't that look beautiful? How many of you guys have been to Israel? Raise your hand. Yeah, me neither, okay? But when I go there, I expect to see that. I'm supposed to go there January 2025 with the Baptist Foundation. Let me give them a plug. It's like $3,400. Start saving your money now, okay? Apparently, that's a good deal. They want me to go, and I'm trying to raise funds for other people that can't afford it too, okay? So, Sea of Galilee. But something happens on the Sea of Galilee, okay? And this is what happens. It says this. Put it up there for me. This. Okay. So now, the thing about the Sea of Galilee that's an issue is that there are frequent storms, right, on the Sea of Galilee. And there's a reason, frequent sudden storms. And there's a reason why science says that this happens. It says this: the sea's location makes it subject to sudden and violent storms as the wind comes over the eastern mountains and drops suddenly onto the sea. Storms are especially likely when an east wind blows cool air over the warm air that covers the sea. The cold air, being heavier, drops as the warm air rises, and this sudden change can produce surprisingly furious storms in a short time, as it did in Jesus' day. That's the scientific reason why storms happen on the Sea of Galilee. Now, I bring that up because as they were sitting there on the Sea of Galilee, one of these storms came. And it says this in verse 37. It says, a fierce windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking over the boat so that the boat was already being swamped. Church, what does swamped mean? Help me out. Yeah, it's taking on water. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? Yeah, it's bad. How many of you have ever been in a boat taking on water? So you're like, I feel like I'm on that boat right now in your sermon. Okay, calm down. You guys relax. Okay, we'll get to it. Okay? All right, yeah. Okay? It's not a good thing. Okay? And so what happened? Where was Jesus? It says, but he was in the stern. Where's the stern? Any boat people here? Victor, it's the back? Can anyone confirm that Victor Vitorius is not lying? Right there. Okay, good. All right. So it's in the back. Okay. All of you online, it's in the back. Victor just confirmed. We have confirmation here. That's right. Okay. So Jesus was in the back, sleeping on the cushion. So you know what they did? They woke him and said to him, teacher, don't you care that we're going to die? This was a pretty serious storm. What did Jesus say? What have we been learning in Sunday school through the years as we've heard sermons after sermon about this? It says, he got up. And what did Jesus do, church? What did he do? He rebuked the wind. You know what rebuke means? It's not like, dear wind, will you please stop blowing? Was it like, oh, pretty please, wind? I sure hope that if you wouldn't just maybe stop blowing a little bit. Is that what Jesus did? Some people believe in just the kind and tender and soft-spoken Jesus. Oh, you know, that's not Jesus. Our Jesus was not just soft-spoken. Okay, although he was tender and although he was kind, all right, this time he rebuked the wind. He rebuked the wind, and he said to the sea, silence, be still. And what happened? What happened, church? Well, what does the Bible say? Sometimes we forget what the Bible says. And it says, when Jesus said to that, the wind just kept on blowing. And the sea just kept on roaring. And that boat was gonna sink. Is that what the Bible says? It was inevitable. It was inevitable. Why did they get in that rickety boat with Jesus? All right, that's what happened. That boat sank. Is that what happened? He experienced shipwreck just like Paul. Is that what happened in this story? No, don't remember it wrong. When Jesus rebuked the sea and he rebuked the storm and he told it to be silent and still, it says the wind ceased. And there was a great calm. And then in verse 40, it says, then he said to them, why are you fearful? Do you still have no faith? And their response wasn't, yes, Jesus, I'm sorry. Or, no, we don't. It was, and they were terrified and asked one another, who then is this? Even the wind and the sea obey him. This is what we're going to look at this morning. You know, first question we're going to ask is this: where do storms come from in our lives? You know, just like with the Sea of Galilee, there is the scientific answer, right? Oh, there's warm air, there's cold air, and then, you know, the warm air rises and the cold air hits the sea, and then that causes a storm that's sudden, and that's why they come, okay? Well, yeah, that is a scientific answer. Just like we can say that storms come into our lives, oh, there's a psychological reason why storms happen in our lives. You know what I mean? It's our psychology. Say, oh, storms happen because our chemistry gets messed up in our bodies. Our chemistry between different people. Again, there's the psychology. That's why storms happen in our lives. Some say it's our biology. Our bodies fail us. Our sin nature, all right, catches up with us. And our bodies aren't made to last more than 120 years. And so, you know, that's why. That creates a storm in our lives. And of course, some take the societal answer. We're very, very attuned to each other these days. Every Sunday morning, I go pick up food from Trader Joe's in order to take to the poor, okay? Or those who don't have food to eat or just need more food, all right? I have about half that food still in my car, okay? Because I handed it off and I wanted to come here and be here on time. Right, I apologize to my sound people who are always taking care of me and my slides. I appreciate you guys so much when I come here, all right? But you know, something interesting happened when I went to Trader Joe's. The guy who wheels the food out, he said, Victor. I said, how are you, man? Because I always want to ask everybody how they're doing because everybody counts, right? How are you doing? He's like, Victor, oh, it's been a crazy week. I said, what do you mean, man? He's like, man, it was like almost like the pandemic all over again. I said, what are you talking about? It's like they stormed our store, man. Our water is gone. Our toilet paper is gone, right? And they just wrecked our store, right? I said, wow. He's like, what was going on out there? It's like, how does everybody, I have people calling me from the East Coast worried about me. What are they telling them? Because our society is so connected that it just blings, and then all of a sudden, oh, that's where the storms come from. Rumors, speculation, right? Those are the scientific answers. And we Christians, we know the scientific answers because God gave us brains and brains to use, right? But we Christians, we also understand that we have a closer relationship with the spiritual answer, right? Where do storms come from in our lives? They don't come from anywhere that God does not allow them to come from. Who told them to get in the boat and go across the sea? Who was it? It was He. Remember we said rested on He? You guys remember that? Okay, if you do, that's good. Short-term memory intact. That's good, okay? And He was who? Who was it? Jesus. That's right. He's the one who told them to get in that boat. Do you think that He knew that the storm was coming? He absolutely did. Just like He knows that storms are coming into your life. I came here today. I had the joy of standing back there in a circle, and I prayed, and I realized I was being loud when I heard myself. Okay? All right? But as we were praying, there were two people that needed prayer because a storm had come into their life. We got a kid in the ICU. We got a niece who got in a car accident. These are storms. You think God knows about these things? He knows about these things. And He's already moving to help with these things. His will is being done. So why do we recognize that then? Well, because we are His. We love Him. And we're calling Him. He says we can. His word says that we can petition Him, right? And so, again, our spiritual answer is that God allows these storms to happen. You know, sometimes, interestingly enough, these storms come out of our best ideas. I have a good idea. You know, this is what we're going to do. In fact, after success, right, after oftentimes, it's not the times of failure in people that I worry about. Sometimes it's mostly the times of success, because when they're successful, we forget that we need God. And when we forget that, sometimes we just rely on our best ideas instead of His best ideas. Want another get-to-know-you moment with Pastor Victor? I'm going to put three names up there. Go ahead, put them up there for me. No, go back. There, right there. All right, let's read those names together so we could stay awake this morning. Let's read the first one. 1, 2, 3. Oh, good. Second one. 1, 2, 3. All right, third one. 1, 2, 3. That's good. You can still see and you can still read. Let's clap it up for yourself. Great job, everybody. You did great. Again, I'm starting school. I'm used to teaching preschool all the way to 12th grade. Now, what are these names? Number one, these are three wonderful girls. Okay? Yes, even Daryl. Okay? All right, Daryl. You know, Daryl Hannah. Right? And what does this represent? These were my three girlfriends before I met my wife, Teresa. Marcy was my high school sweetheart. I went to Whitney High School in Cerritos. Daryl was my college sweetheart. I went to UC Irvine, right here. All right, well, I am very close to a place that I call home, okay? All right? And Jackie was my medical school sweetheart. That's right. And let me tell you, I had a great day, a great idea with all of them because they were all amazing girls. I was gonna marry them. I knew it. God had brought this girl into my life. She was great for me. I'm gonna have a great life. We're gonna get married. We're gonna have babies. All right. We're gonna travel the world. We're gonna have a great life together. Right? And that was great until the day that they all left me. They broke up with me, right? For different reasons. Oh, you guys don't even look sad about that. You guys are all smiling at me like this is like a funny, this is like heart-wrenching stuff, guys. All right? But the point is, this was my best idea, right? That this was going to happen. But God had a better idea. A woman who came at the right time and had the right chemistry, okay? Because it's not just about compatibility, it's about timing. That's what I tell the teenagers. That's what I tell the college kids. Heck, that's what I tell the adults. And I don't have to talk to the kids because they just want to play together, right? Right? And her name was Teresa. And we've built a great life together. We have 4 kids. She thought she was marrying a doctor. I became a pastor, and she didn't leave me, okay? All right? And what does it tell you? It tells you that our best ideas are still worse than his because our best is not the same as God's best. That's why it says in Isaiah, "My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine." I know there's a lot of experience in this room. I know there's a lot of wisdom in this room. Even more so, collectively. But not a one of us is more smarter than God. Not a one of us is smarter than God. There is not any number of papers I can put on the wall that make me smarter than God. So as our best ideas sometimes cause storms in our own life, let us make sure that as we have good ideas, let's run them by the Lord. In fact, let's not just run them by the Lord and assume what his answer is. Let's give them to the Lord. And then listen. My dad stopped talking to me for a little while. You know why? Because I would go to him for advice. He would say a bunch of stuff, and then I would just do the opposite every single time. I said, "Dad, why you stop talking to me?" He said, "Son, there's no point in talking to you." I said, "What do you mean, Dad? You love me. You're my dad. I love you, Dad." He was like, "There's no point in talking to you, son. Because you're just going to do whatever you want to do anyways. When are you going to slow down and listen to what I'm saying? At least make me feel like you heard what I said." "What did I just say?" I said, "I don't know." He said, "Why don't you know?" "Well, I was thinking about something else." And that's often us as we're thinking about our best answer, our best solution in our lives. Okay? All right. Now, interestingly enough, all right, so we see that. Let's make sure that our best, that's point number one, okay? Now, interestingly enough, it says that when that windstorm arose and the waves were breaking over the boat so that the boat was already being swamped and Jesus was in the stern, it says that they woke him up and asked him, what does it say, church? What does it say? Go ahead, church, it's your turn. Yeah, teacher, don't you care that we're going to die? Let me translate that into our context right here. Put it up there for me. They're asking, God, are you even there? Do you care about me? Now, surely nobody in this church has ever asked those questions. Actually, everybody's asked those questions. In fact, when things happen, give me the next slide. These questions, I don't want you to feel guilty about them. This isn't a Catholic church. This is a Christian church, okay? All right? They make sense. Okay? These questions make sense, all right, to ask those questions, okay? But what was Jesus doing during the storm? When they were thinking these things, when they were wondering these things, what was he doing? He was sleeping, right? In verse 36, it says he was in the stern, which we know from Victor Venturis is the back of the church, confirmed by the gentleman helping me with the slides, right? And again, he was sleeping, all right? And what does this sleeping show? Jesus was sleeping. Why? Why could he sleep so soundly while everybody else was stressing out and freaking out on that boat? Because was Jesus worried about the storm? Jesus wasn't worried about the storm. Jesus ain't worried about the storms in your life either. He cares about them. I mean, that's why he was there. He wasn't like, hey guys, I'm going to stay with these people and continue to teach them. You get on the boat. Okay, now there was sometimes the time that he did that, but if you remember the next time, somebody came walking on water, so we could do that in a different sermon, okay? But this time he was in the boat, he cared about them, but he wasn't worried, man. Storms, rain, rain's coming down. All right, there's, oh my gosh, people yelling, oh, the boat is swamped, this is Jesus. No, did Jesus snore? No, okay, it doesn't say in the Bible, okay? So, okay, that's not in our Bible. If you have a Bible that says that Jesus snored, let me see it, okay? We probably got to throw it out, okay? I'll give you a new one, okay? All right, I don't know if Jesus has sleep apnea like me, reflux like me, okay? But Jesus, he clearly was sleeping. Why? Because he's not worried. You know why? Because Jesus is God. And as I learned, Jesus is oh so amazing. Everybody say Jesus is oh so amazing. Go. Oh, you did it wrong, church. Come on now. Jesus is oh so amazing. Very good. The blood is flowing. The adrenaline's kicking in. Good. All right. Jesus is oh so amazing. I learned this from my Sunday school teacher. My Sunday school teacher. The same, that's the person, right? She told me that Jesus is oh so amazing. Oh as in oh omnipotent. Oh as in oh omniscient. And oh as in oh omnipresent. You said, Pastor Victor, I didn't go to seminary. What does that mean? Those are big words. What'd you do? I didn't even take the SAT. It's okay, let me help you. Okay? Because this is the faith of fishermen and of Pharisees. Okay? Some of these people barely heard what Jesus said one time, and it was enough for them to come to faith in Jesus. Okay? So here's the thing. Omnipotent means what? Anybody know? Come on, church. Omnipotent. All powerful. Is your Jesus still all powerful? Is he? If he is, say amen. And believe it. He is all powerful. All right? Just like I told the kids. Is there any storm that would come into their life that Jesus is not more powerful in? If the answer is yes, then I just lied to a bunch of kids in front of their parents and their grandparents. Oh my goodness, what kind of person am I? Right? No. Jesus is all powerful. Okay? Jesus is omniscient, which means what? Omniscient? Anybody? All-knowing. Very good. Gold star over here. He knows everything. He knows even before you say anything what you're going to say. He knows what's going to happen. All right? Why? You know, because he cares. We were fearfully, wonderfully made, and before somewhere, all the days of our lives are written in a book. What does it mean? I don't have access to that book. I don't want access to that book. I don't want to be God. Because if I was God, a bunch of people would just instantaneously disappear just like that. Okay? And then I'd have to feel bad about it because of my terrible nature. Okay? Person that cut me off, poof, they'd be gone. Person that got the last bubble gum at Target, poof, they'd be gone. Okay? He knows. He knows. Does that bring you comfort? I hope it does. Because there's plenty of times in my life leading everything that I lead where I just don't know. I said, Victor, what do we do? I said, guys, I don't know. They're like, you don't know. If you don't know, who's going to know? I was like, God's going to know. They're like, oh, yeah, God. I was like, come on, what do you mean, oh, yeah, God? You guys are the leaders of our denomination. You're leaders of other denominations. Like, what do you mean? You've been professors, pastors for decades longer than me. What do you mean, oh, yeah, God? That's why I preach these sermons. Because sometimes when we get into the complex, deep things, we listen to all the videos, podcasts, we forget about the simple things that God is to wear. We need to be. Doesn't the Bible say something about returning to your first love? That's what we got to do. And of course, he's omnipresent. He's here right now. I'm talking about him. He's here. And I hope I'm making him happy. Our God is there. And he's oh so amazing. When does the service end, Victor? When I'm done. Okay, very good. Well, then let me show you a picture. Yeah. Do you guys know who that is? Yeah, that's me. That's why you're smiling. Thank you. I appreciate that. You recognize it's me. That's right. Next to this me is this beautiful girl. That's my daughter, Vanessa. She's 13 years old this year. She's entering high school. Okay. Vanessa's my second child. All right. They call her the middle child. Somebody told her early on that nobody loves middle children. And I said, that's not true. I love you. I love you just as much as I love all my other kids. Well, when Vanessa was born, all right, there was a story leading up to the born, that's another sermon for another time. But at some point when she was little, she came home one day from church. And we noticed that as she came home from church, all of a sudden this lump started to form on her neck. And when this lump started to form, we thought, oh, that's weird, a bug bit her. Except that lump kept getting bigger and bigger. Now, she was like probably 2 years old. And soon this lump was almost as big as half of her neck. So we were very concerned. My wife was crying. I wanted to cry, but since at that point I hadn't cried since I was 13 years old, you know, I wasn't going to do that, but I felt very sad, I guess I can say. And we took her to the hospital. They said, oh, this is not good. You know, she's going to need to have surgery. Something that's encapsulated itself, the medicine's not getting there. She's going to have surgery. Surgery? How are you going to take that big knife and stick it into my kid's neck? What do you mean this is going to happen? God, I just got her from you. That was like 2 years ago. And I said, okay, this is a safe surgery, right? Where everything's going to be okay, right, doctor? They said, well. I said, what do you mean, well? Don't tell me that. And everything he said after that, I don't even remember, because he said, well. He didn't say, yes, she was going to be okay. They put her in the tiniest gown that I've ever seen. Okay? You know, the kind that you're naked in the back, right? She had a little diaper on. And, you know, we hugged her, cried, we prayed. You know, her older sister was there, 1 year older. And then the nurse came and said, it's time. I said, it's time for what? Papa Bear's kicking in. It's time to take her downstairs. I said, well, to the OR. So we went downstairs, and there's these double doors. There's double doors where you got to have a key card to go in. And a nurse came out of those double doors and said, okay, we're ready. I said, we're ready for what? We're ready to take Vanessa into surgery. My wife's holding Vanessa. And you know, the nurse comes to take her. I say, yeah, hold on, I was a doctor. I should surely go through those doors. And they said, no, sir, you can't. You cannot do that for this and at this hospital. You need to give us Vanessa. And so I can tell you that I've done a lot of hard things in my life, but one of the hardest things I've ever done in my life was take that child from my wife and give her to that nurse. Now the next couple hours were really hard. A storm, the biggest storm that had ever hit my life, came. It's all fun and games until that moment. But we prayed. And we trusted. And every minute seemed like an hour. So I get it. But wouldn't you know it, a couple hours later, they came out and they said, okay, she's okay. She made it through. And when you ask her today, she's like, what? That happened to me? And now she tries to use it, you know? So can we go to Target and can you buy me something? I'm like, no. You know what I mean? But our God is faithful. He is omnipotent, which means he's going to take care of this. He can take care of this situation. He's omniscient, which means he knows exactly how I'm feeling. And he was omnipresent, which means not only was I there, he was there. So what's the issue with this storm? Why did Jesus put his disciples through this storm? The issues in these storms actually isn't the storm, right? Because after he got up, rebuked the wind, and said, silence, be still, the wind ceased, and there was a great calm, and he asked his question. Wasn't that a crazy storm? Is that what he asked? Did you see how powerful I did? I just was like this, and the storm stopped. Is that what Jesus said? No. He turned to his disciples. They asked him a very interesting question, an awkward question. Why are you afraid? Do you still have no faith? I'll check to see if that word was there, you know, in the Aramaic and the Greek. It's there. Do you still have no faith? You know what that word still is for? It's not for first-time Christians. It's not for new believers. It's for long-time believers. That after all this time, all the miracles you've seen me do, all the food that you've seen me multiply, everything, the stories you heard of how I'm born, everything that we spent all this time together, you still have no faith? It wasn't an issue with the storm. Storms come so that we can build our faith and so that God can show us his miracles and so that we can deepen our relationship even in the times where he doesn't answer our prayers the way we want them to. If you were to listen to me, that pandemic would have lasted one day. And I would have went on my Panama Canal cruise that year. He didn't listen to me. You know why he didn't listen to me? Because I'm not God. He is. And as our dear Victor said to us, God is good. He's good all the time. And all the time he is good. And that's why we believe that. We hold on to that. Because we believe in a good God. We need to have faith. We need to have faith in all these different situations. Put them up there for me. Every day when we get sick, when it seems like he's not there, when our solutions don't seem to work, when the normal isn't normal anymore, when we are in pain, when God gives us great victory and must not swell into pride in ourselves, with the small things and the big things, we have to have faith that God's going to help us to find our car keys, okay? We have to have faith that God cares. He cares. You have to have faith that he knows you are there. He hasn't lost you. We have to have faith in his word. There's a lot of Christians that don't believe that the Bible is completely true. I don't understand this at all, okay? We have to have faith in the time that he has given you to live on this earth, that if you are still here, it is for a reason and for a purpose and because we need you, and we have to have faith in the calling that he's given you. Okay, and that is why when storms hit in life, we have this other great verse in Psalm 46, 10, 11 that says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in all the earth. Why? Okay, because I am who I am. And through your faith, you're going to show them the Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Be still. He stilled the storms. Can he still you today? Can he still you today? Can he still your heart to have faith in him? He can still this hurricane if he wants to. He can turn it into a tropical storm if he wants to. Or he can turn it into a light breeze. But some of the people that are the hardest beings on this earth, for him to still sit in this room and on this earth, it's human beings, because he loves us enough to give us free will. But he calls us in love to be still, and I'm calling you in love to be still. I know there's a lot going on, but please, before you come up with your best solutions, be still and know that I am God. And they asked themselves that wonderful question, and they were terrified of, who then is this? Even the wind and the sea obey him. When you ask yourself that question, who is this God that I believe in? Is he still God? I hope he is. Faith happens by growing him and knowing him, because faith is extreme trust. So this morning, church, I want you to challenge you to do three things. Have faith in what God is doing in your life, even as crazy as it gets. Okay? Have faith in what he's doing in your life. Number two, have faith in what God is doing with your life. But most especially if you're walking according to his word. If you're not walking in right relationship with him, then you need to fix that today. I'm just here to tell you that. You know, they bring me in to drop bombs and then leave, okay? You need to fix that, okay? But if you're walking according to his word, then have faith in what he is doing with your life, okay? But to encourage you here this morning, number three, have faith in what God is doing with this church family. This church is not this beautiful building. Oh, you have done amazing work with this building. I mean, look at all those lights. My God, there's not a single one without a bulb. They are like all on. That is so different from First Southern Anaheim. We're like different color bulbs, just whichever one was the cheapest, we screwed it in. You know what I mean? Like, look at this place. It's like pristine. I love coming here. It smells good here. You know what I mean? People are nice. The rows are pearls. It's beautiful. But that's not the church. The church is you. Church happened today because thankfully you came here. And the president of this whole state was going to come here and preach whether there was anybody here or not. Because I came here to be the church. I knew at least one or two of you would be here, and that was enough. That was enough for me, because I'm not too big for my britches, okay? And I love you, all right? So let us have faith in these things, even as the storms come, not just for ourselves, but for that great cloud of witnesses that is around your life as the influencers and the amazing people that you are. Shall we bow our heads in prayer together? Heavenly Father, I thank you for this morning. Oh, Lord God, you had me preach a longer message this morning. But thank you, Father God, for the joy it was to preach your word and to expound, Father God, on who you are. Lord, I love you. It's so fun to tell them about who you are. Now, Lord, I pray that as we scattered these seeds today, that it finds fertile ground, Lord God, in the hearts of these amazing people, my brothers and sisters. Father, I pray that you help them in their lives. We prayed for the special needs, but we petition you, God. I'm begging you, Lord. Father, for health. Health, Lord Jesus, in these situations. Father, please help us. Father, I pray for the stuff that people don't even want to talk to other people about that's going on in their life, Father God. You know, help them, God. And through it, help them to have faith in you. But I also pray, Lord, that you bless this church. That you bless this church, Father God, with a good future, but also a good now. Because the people are here and those kids are here, Father God. So continue, Father God, to help us move in your direction. And God, again, help us to grow in every way. I love you, Lord. Thank you for this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Victor. I felt like I was at that wedding that they had, and they ran out of wine. And then Jesus made that wine that Even one of the guests said, this is the best wine I've ever tasted. But he said it for the end, and I feel that we were blessed with those extra minutes. Amen, church? Amen. Well, we've got Bible study at 6:30, along with prayer. And last week, we studied faith, and how appropriate to tie in faith, and we went deep into it. And we would invite you to attend that. You can watch it online. And we will invite you back next week, too. We'll be here, and we'll look forward to worshiping with you. Greg, Audrey, if you would come up and lead us in a closing song. God is good, and all the time. Let's stand as we close in worship and singing to our Lord.
Just sing Awesome God through a couple of times. I think that's appropriate for what we've heard this morning. Thank you.